Folks, in the schedule for today, there is a lot happening today, and we don't want to miss a couple of more ongoing monthly activities, those being the regular every month meeting of Congregational Council on the second Sunday of the month, and also the meeting of the St. John Women of ELCA, that being at 6 o'clock on the second Sunday of the month, so 4 o'clock and 6 o'clock. One addition to the schedule that we didn't receive in time to get in the bulletin is that the Girl Scout troop is also meeting this afternoon here at the church, and that is going to be at 2 p.m. Tomorrow we also have an addition, and that is Conference Cabinet, Upper Dauphin Conference Cabinet, will be meeting here at the church downstairs at 7 o'clock, in addition to dartball taking place tomorrow evening. And I would just mention the somewhat different office hours tomorrow. I'll be in for a very brief time and then getting on the road for a day of visits to our persons who live at a distance from the church. Thursday, deadline for submitting items for the newsletter. And the thing to note there is that is both December and January. This is the combined issue that we do in the wintertime as we do one in the summer. So if you have anything either relating to December or January, this would be the time to please be sure to get that in. We've had a note for a while now about the heating zones here at the church, and Tammy R. Sexton had just asked that I might, again, highlight that for you. When she does her check at the end of each day, there are times, of course, where doors are still open or maybe thermostats aren't turned down. What we try for is, during the week, this area here is its own heating zone, and it stays at 55 degrees during the week, coming up on Sunday morning or when we have special worship. The next heating zone is basically everything outside the doors upstairs here, and also the foyer downstairs, as well as the conference room. That we typically keep set at 60 degrees. So if you happen to see that for some reason that's something other than 60, if you can turn that down, please, that would be great. The Sunday school room then is its own zone, the office, Miss Laurie's classroom, and the main Sunday school room, and that we keep at 60, except of course when there's an activity going on, then we want it nice and warm. But if you happen to be in there and you are a part of an activity and it ends and everybody's headed out, if you could be so kind as to check that thermostat right by my office door and make sure that it is down to 60 at the end, we'd appreciate it. And then the final one is maybe the smallest one, and that's the new addition where the elevator is located, that hallway. And that we also keep, generally speaking, at 60 degrees. So between them, needless to say, it's helpful to keep the doors closed so that if we have the heat up, let's say in the Sunday school room, we're not also losing heat out into the foyer or out into the hallway by the elevator. So just kind of a reminder, we haven't had to think about heat for a while. And in a way, I think it's a very nice problem to have. I'm not missing that heat and humidity of summer, but it does mean, once again, thinking about such things as thermostats and keeping doors closed in the interest of good stewardship. We have the honor of hosting, not this coming Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, the annual Berriesburg Area Ecumenical Thanksgiving Worship. So that means 7 p.m., the eve of Thanksgiving, Wednesday the 21st. Things are pretty much falling into place for that. One need that I do have is greeters for that evening. So if there would be a person or persons who would be interested in serving as greeters for Thanksgiving Eve, just catch me, please, after worship and let me know of your availability. We have a birthday request in the bulletin in print this morning for Rosina Barry, as you've hopefully seen by now. She has a 90th birthday coming up on November 20. And her daughter had asked on behalf of the family that, again, we might give cards for Rosina to her in honor of her 90th birthday. We're pleased to have Marzette Hoffman's brother Merle visiting with us this morning. And he mentioned to me that a couple of weeks ago he sent a letter my way asking the same for Marzette, because her birthday is also coming up. And for some reason, I haven't seen that. That would have been during vacation time. And I guess maybe sometimes things can go awry. But the point being, we have two card requests this morning. So if you could please keep in mind, Marzette will be celebrating her 90th birthday on the 15th of the month. So November 15, that would be this coming week, will be her birthday, 90th birthday. Rosina's then the following week. And it would be wonderful if we could indeed provide both of those folks with cards of greeting and prayer. Rosina's address, of course, is in print here. Marzette's would be the one at Premier at Susquehanna. And so that one is probably more familiar to us all. But if you could please give response to both of those, that would be greatly appreciated. Finally, today is, of course, Veterans Day. Before it was Veterans Day, it was Armistice Day. And that is because, as you probably have not been able to not hear anywhere, it was 100 years ago today that the armistice was signed, which marked the end of World War I. At the time, certainly a cause for great rejoicing. In the hindsight of history, we know not so much, because unfortunately the peace, as it was, that followed really set the stage then for World War II and everything that would follow that. But in light of that day, it evolved into Veterans Day, And so there are many things going on. One of the things that we have done as a congregational family for some time is recognize those in our midst who have served in the armed forces or who do serve. And so we traditionally have folks stand and just say a word, if you would please, about what branch of the military, when, what time frame, if it was a certain period of conflict in the world, and the like. We very much appreciate any interesting honors that you received as well would be a great thing. So could you please stand? I know everybody's bashful, especially those who have served. Come on, stand up now. No being bashful. And we're going to just ask you to stay standing for a little bit, please. We have a couple of other things to say. So how about if we start over here with Roy and then Jeff and Fred and then Larry and Carl and then over to Ron, and we'll work our way across, okay? Nice and loud.
I was in the Air Force from 92 to 99. I served Special Operations Command. I've been over in, I was over in, during Sarajevo conflict, and I served also in Korea.
Thank you.
Jeff? My name is Jeff Huffington. I served 3 years in the Army, the 101st Air Force Division. I served a year in Vietnam, where I got Purple Heart, the Bronze Star, Army Commendation Medal, and an Air Medal.
And that translates, Jeff, those honors you received, twice wounded in combat, right, during the course of that time serving. Thank you. Larry?
Marine Reserves, 6 years.
July 6th.
Sorry, Larry. We'll go to Carl and then to you, Larry. Two Larrys. Oh, my goodness. I have to look up Larry. Larry Gehring, then Carl, then Larry Gessner. Larry Gehring. Sorry, Larry, would you please?
Marine Reserves, 6 years, Vietnam area.
Thank you. Carl?
I served 6 years in the U.S. Army Reserve, mostly at Fort Eugene, down Gap.
Thank you. Up to Larry and Balco.
Hey, I started July 16, 1956. Don't forget those dates. And the ending was September 30th. One thing that I do recall is I was on ship destroyer number 3, your homeboard Norfolk, when the Cuban Missile Crisis broke out. And I didn't know what was going on that day, but we did learn later when President Kennedy performed the phone services on radio and that. But we were, the ship itself, we were number 2 out in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. And that was our patrolling area.
Dramatic time in history, for sure. Thank you. And Larry was kind enough, I'll say more about this other display in a moment, but Larry was kind enough to provide for us, we would think of it as United States flag, a color. The Navy has a different name for it, but that is flag that is draped over there on the pew, was flown over a nuclear attack submarine in port, on which Mark Gessner was serving at the time, and by Mark's commanding officer then was presented to Mark's dad, whom he knew was also a Navy man. So we're grateful to Larry for providing that this morning.
Actually, it was the chief of the fourth class, right?
Or chief? Oh, okay. So the head enlisted person, yeah. Then I guess, Larry. Yep, got it. Thank you. Ron, please.
Pennsylvania National Guard, 6 years, Spec 5 public information sessions.
Thank you, Ron.
Janine Chalker, I did 15 years in the Army Reserves, 2 years over in Iraq, and child number 4 got me out.
So there's a provision there somewhere in how that works.
Makes sense if I'm not going anymore.
Gotcha. Thank you. Bob? Bob?
2 years in the Army, ordnance ammunition from 54 to 56.
2 years in the Army from 53 to 55.
Thank you all. Let's give a round. Please stand. Thanks, thank you. And as they are seated, hopefully you noted in the bulletin a couple of things happening locally. One is we will be dedicating the banners in Berriesburg this afternoon. Members of local veterans organizations, area pastors, elected officers of Berriesburg. That'll be taking place up on the square. The idea was weather permitting, pretty good weather, so I think we're safe in saying it will be at the square in Berriesburg. As you may know, we sponsored one of those banners as a congregational family in honor of the folks that just announced themselves in memory of those who have died previously but who served. And if you want to see that particular banner, the folks doing the planning and the organizing were kind enough to put it right outside of our house. I did not realize that was the final decision, but I went out that day and there it was. So as you're heading into Berriesburg from the church, right beyond our house, the pole that divides, in a sense, our house from our trees, you'll see the St. John Berriesburg banner there with a very lovely picture of the church and announcing that we do give thanks for those who have served from our membership. The other event this evening at 6:30 is a special musical evening that's happening up at Himmel's Church. And Carol Hubler, our own Carol, is a major part of that. And again, that promises to be a wonderful evening of tribute to veterans on this 100th anniversary of the very first Armistice Veterans Day. The display here in the front was from an observance that Faye Nichols was kind enough to lead us in this morning at the beginning of Sunday school, especially calling attention to the people that we would not be able to honor in person, those being the folks missing in action. So it is a ceremony honoring those who are MIA, and of course, as such, may well be held prisoner to this time. So if you want to know more about that, you might check with Faye about that. And it occurs to me, last but certainly not least, Dan and Ange, to my knowledge, the only person currently from our congregational family who serves in the armed forces in any capacity is Logan, your son. Would one of you not mind too much just saying a quick word about what he's doing just now in the reserves?
He's currently in Virginia right now, but he'll be back next week. Okay. He's doing some special training to get ready for his deployment to Poland next year.
Okay. That's next year, then, Ange. Okay. Thank you. So we add Logan to that list of people for whom we give thanks and who we honor. All right, with that then, we'll turn this morning, this coming on the end of the Pentecost season, Pentecost Sunday number 25, to Judy for this morning's prayer. our starting point on page 94 in the front of the red worship book. Please stand as we prepare to worship God. First and foremost, we gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us now confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, forgive us, forgive us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
show forth your almighty power chiefly by reaching out to us in mercy. Grant us the fullness of your grace, strengthen our trust in your promises, and bring all the world to share in the treasures that come through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And you may be seated as we read from the scriptures.
The first reading comes from the 17th chapter of 1 Kings. This chapter begins the story of Elijah. God sends a drought on Israel because of the sins of King Ahab. This passage depicts God's saving acts not only on behalf of Elijah, but also on behalf of those who are associated with the prophet, even a foreigner, the widow of Zarephath. Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, saying, "Go now to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and live there, for I have commanded a widow there to feed you." So he set out and went to Zarephath. When he came to the gate of the town, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and said, "Bring me a little water in a vessel so that I may drink." As she was going to bring it, he called to her and said, "Bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." But she said, "As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am now gathering a couple of sticks so that I may go home and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you have said. But first, make me a little cake of it and bring it to me. And afterwards, make something for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, the jar of meal will not be empty, and the jug of oil will not fail until the day that the Lord sends rain on the earth." She went and did as Elijah said, so that she, as well as he and her household, ate for many days. The jar of meal was not empty, neither did the jug of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord that he spoke by Elijah. Let us read responsibly Psalm 146. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, O my soul.
I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being.
Put not your trust in rulers, in mortals in whom there is no help.
When they do their last, they return to earth, and in that day their thoughts perish.
Happy are they who have the God of Jacob for their help, whose hope is in the Lord their God. Who gives justice to those who are oppressed, and food to those who hunger. The Lord sets the captive free.
The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous.
The Lord cares for the stranger. The Lord sustains the orphan and widow, but frustrates the way of the wicked.
The Lord shall reign forever. Your God is ever and ever.
The second reading comes from the 9th chapter of Hebrews. The letter to the Hebrews describes Christ as a high priest who offers himself as a sacrifice for our sin. Christ does not die again and again each year. He died once, is alive with God, and will reveal himself on the last day. Christ did not enter a sanctuary made by human hands, a mere copy of the true one, but he entered into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Nor was it to offer himself again and again, as the high priest enters the holy place year after year with blood that is not his own. For then he would have had to suffer again and again since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the age to remove sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for mortals to die once, and after that the judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him.
Places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses and for the sake of appearance say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation. Jesus then sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then Jesus called his disciples and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she out of her poverty has put in everything she had, all she had to give." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. You may be seated. As you are, Ms. Laurie's coming forward before we dismiss the young persons with Miss Laurie, and before the hymn, we're going to hear from a certain sidekick of Miss Laurie.
Absolutely. The kids want to come up and sit up front today. And before I get started, could I have Jamie Doyle and Matt Unitwitz to come up? What about you? That's so good. Oh my goodness, Sonny, you're all dolled up.
I sure am, Miss Laurie. Now it's because we're about to play.
Oh, that's right. Good morning, friends, and welcome to this edition of
The Price is Right!
All right, let's get right to it and welcome our contestants, Sonny. All right, contestant number one is Molly Moneybags. Say hello to everyone, Molly.
Good morning.
Sonny, tell us a little bit about Molly.
Sure will, Miss Laurie. Molly is one of the richest ladies in town. She has the biggest house, and she has the nicest clothing, and you should see her swimming pool. You could float a yacht in it.
I bet she has one of those, too.
Yeah, she does. Let's just say, this lady has a lot of cash.
All right. Sonny, now let's meet our other contestant. Contestant number two. It's Charlie Churchmax. Say hello, Charlie. Sonny, would you say that Charlie's a little poor?
I prefer to call him financially challenged.
Okay. So he doesn't have very much money?
Yeah, he's a bit lacking in that area.
All right. Thanks, Sonny. Now, contestants, we're ready to play The Price is Right. Recently, both of you, Molly Moneybags and Charlie Churchmouse, you went to church. When the offering plate came around, Molly put in $10,000. Wow. Charlie put some money in the offering plate too. He gave $10. All right, we're going to go to the judges now for this question. You guys are my judges. Are you ready? Who put in more money? Wait a second. Raise your hand if you think it was Molly Moneybags, $10,000, or do you think it was $10 over there from Charlie Churchmouse? Who put in the most? You think that Molly Moneybags did?
Well, of course, Miss Laurie Einstein, we are little, but we know how to count. $10,000 is way more than $10.
Okay, but let's hear what the Bible has to say on that answer. Based on what I read in the Bible in Mark 12, it says that Charlie gave more. Excuse me, Miss Laurie. I don't know what kind of calculators they used back in Bible times when you were living, but here in the 21st century, $10,000 is way more than 10. Well, son, before airing, you asked both contestants a question. We know how much money they gave, but now we're going to find how much of their money they gave. Okay?
Okay.
So, what did Molly tell you?
Well, Molly Moneybags told me that she just stuck her hand in under the couch cushions and pulled out some money and put it in the plate.
Okay. So she gave some of her money.
Right. And she said that she has lots more left. But
we don't have to worry. Okay, we won't. Now, how about Charlie Churchmouse?
Well, he just said he had $10 in his piggy bank, so that's all he gave.
So Charlie gave all of what he had.
That's right.
Okay, back to my judges. Which is more, some or all? What do you think? Is some the most or is all the most? Raise your hand for all. That's right. All is the most. And what do you think, Sonny?
Well, I guess we learned today that God uses a different calculator when he looks at what we give him.
You can say that.
I guess we learned today that God uses a different calculator when we look at what we give him.
That's right. Let's say a quick prayer and then we'll say goodbye. Hold your hands. Heavenly Father, help us to be like Charlie Churchmouse and give God our all, so no matter what we're doing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, say goodnight, Sonny.
Good night, Sonny, and thanks for playing. The Price is Right!
Thank you, friends. Oh, you know what? While I still have the mic, I just wanted to comment on a few things. Last week we had the best day for our second annual hayride. Noah's Ark took off, and it was a perfect day for doing that. We had 14 kids, actually double that because we loaded up 2x2. So that was a great day. And on Wednesday, we had our first meeting of the Celebration Club. It was great. It was awesome. There were 17 kids came for that 2 hours. And so many kids came that I didn't have enough stuff. I was, you know, maybe thinking, oh, maybe 10 will come, but I'll prepare for 12. But we had 17, so it was awesome. We had to share, so it was great. They ranged in age from preschool all the way up to fourth grade, and every age group was represented. It was an awesome time, so I'm hoping in December we have even more. And next week, I just wanted to put one thing. Next week we're having a celebration decoration party. And I think the youth are participating in that also. Families are to come downstairs. We're going to make decorations. We're going to have a tree down in the celebration space. And normally the ladies decorate it for us, which is great. But I thought it would be cool if we decorated it. So we're going to make ornaments for the tree. We're going to make garland. We're going to make other decorations for downstairs. Sandy Bixler is helping get things together. So it'll be very creative. So hopefully you all can stay as a family and help us. We're going to have pizza right after church, and then we're going to make the decorations. And then on December 2nd, we're going to decorate during Sunday celebration. So hopefully we'll see you next week, too. Thank you. Okay, kids, we can go back to it.
Thank you.
Miss Laurie and Sonny and, was it Molly Moneybags? Molly Moneybags and Charlie Churchmouse did a bang-up job at, you know, it sounds so simple, right? Yeah, no, of course. God looks at things differently than we do. And God knows when somebody is putting in $1,000 for whatever the particular need may be, which to them is no more than a few dollars for someone else because they are people of extreme wealth. We know that, but you know, it totally makes sense. And yet, the thing is, it's so hard to remember. It's not that it's a difficult concept. It's not that it's complicated. It's not that it doesn't make sense thinking about God as we come to see God in the person of Jesus and in the pages of the Bible. The thing is, remembering it, that's what's hard. Because we are, all of us, I'm guessing, parts of various other very worthwhile organizations. Not-for-profit organizations that serve many different causes in God's world. In Anne's and my case, we belong to many things that deal with parks and environmental issues. And we admire the work that all of them do. That's why we support them. But every single one, when it comes time to make that annual gift, to renew your membership, whatever the case may be, they all have gradations of giving, right? And you see this in the organizations, no doubt, of which you're a part as well. You know, there's the bottom level, you know, something like member or, you know, some very basic name. I'm part of a Civil War history group that the very basic level is recruit. You know, nothing too exciting about that. And you go on up, I'm thinking it's like major general, you know, is way up there at the top. But if you start at the bottom, and that's all the money you would give your, you know, your recruit. Nothing very exciting there. We're proud supporters of WITF, National Public Radio. Wonderful stuff. And yet I get so tired of WITF, you know, talking about joining the Premier Circle for only, gosh, I don't know, it's not $100 a day. It's maybe it's $100 a month. But something like, you know, that obviously the goal is you really ought to consider getting to the Premier Circle. Who would not want to be in the Premier Circle, right? You know, do you want to just be a donor or do you want to be a Premier Circle member? Well, heck yeah. Another Gettysburg Battlefield support group of which I'm part, you can be a First Corps member. Now, if you don't know your Gettysburg history, the First Corps was probably, somewhat arguably, but not by much, the group of soldiers that did the most memorable, amazing work in setting the stage for there to be a Union victory at Gettysburg, and many people would say because of that, then the North winning the Civil War. So it's a big deal to be part of the First Corps. You know, that's as good as it gets. And of course, if not, well, then you're somewhere down. So, you know, you get hit by enough of this stuff, you live through a campaign season where everything is all about money, you know, where people, you hear that this candidate or that candidate held a $250 a plate benefit, and you think, oh my gosh, you know, who can go to that? And you realize that, of course, there are those people that $250, you know, that's, again, like opening your wallet or mine and pulling out a one or a five. Sure, why not? No big deal. So, you know, we get barraged again and again and again and again and again and again. Everywhere else that we turn, that it's so easy then to come to this place. It's so easy to look then within our congregational family and just sort of not even meaning to, bring that kind of thinking along with us. And maybe especially so when we're coming into the time of year where we are, right, budget time. You know, as Dan was reminding us all the other week, last week, In your newsletter that'll be coming at the end of the month, you'll have the budget for 2019. And Jamie, as always, I mean, Molly Moneybags has done an amazing job. That we'll have to work with that, Jamie. Jamie, our treasurer, has done, again, a wonderful job of making it so clear and breaking it all out. And, you know, when you start to look at it, I find, at least as an ex-accountant, as a person, you know, who thinks in terms of numbers, it's so hard not to get caught up with how do we make sure we have enough money to make it happen. You know, I mentioned last week that Miss Laurie, you just saw the wonderful ministry yet again that she's doing with us and with all of our young persons. But that means next year again that we step up once more the threshold of making the offerings needed to make that happen. And as we look at the giving this year, for instance, here in 2018, as I was sharing last week, it's by no means the worst year we've ever had in terms of the regular current fund expenses. It would be the top of the lower third, let's say. You know, so not halfway even, it's in the bottom part. But by no means worse, by any means. But my guess is part of that, of course, is we're doing really well in stepping up to meet the goals of the Children and Youth Fund, which helped to make sure that Ms. Laurie's ministry is adequately funded. So, you know, all those things start to run through our minds, and we start to look at budgets, and we start to think amounts, and it's so easy to forget what is so very simple, that Jesus simply does not look at the giving and the receiving the same way that we do. Now, I would leave with you the thought that that has impact then on both the receiving end, but also the giving end. You know, on the receiving end, which I've mainly been speaking about, you know, thinking as a person who follows the budget, who looks at what we're planning for next year, what Jesus reminds us of is that as tempting as it may be, we don't want to ever let ourselves fall into the trap that pretty much rules the rest of the world. We are a part of a congregational family, a church family. We follow a God who knows about and who cares about, first and foremost, what is in the heart. Thank God, God doesn't just look at the outside. God doesn't just take things at face value. Jesus does not simply go with what strikes him at first appearance. God in Christ is good at looking to the heart. And so, as a congregational family, we need to be reminded again and again that it's not about the dollars. That if we're following faithfully, if we are living and doing what it is that God intends, as we see that in Jesus, then we trust that God will work it out. So we're never going to get there by getting all caught up in the dollars, by creating giving circles and all of the rest, and we don't. We don't label things that people give, and maybe you've wondered about that. You go to other churches, you know, and you see a window given in memory of, given in honor of, you see some worship item presented in loving memory of, you know, obviously making clear who the donor was. With extremely rare exceptions, we don't do that here. That has not been the history for a very, very long time. Because, again, the temptation is always to become all about the recognizing and the recognition. And we know that God looks at things differently. But it also has meaning on the giving side as well. And that goes for both. The one being that we don't give, you know, just to meet budgets. We don't give just to make expenses. We don't give, certainly, as Jesus makes clear, for recognition. You know, the reason that he knows people are putting in large sums there in the treasury that day is because they make sure he knew. And not particularly Jesus, but everybody there. The people who were coming in with the big amounts had people with them who would make sure to call attention to the fact, make way, here is George Moneybags coming to put his very large gift in the communal chest, so step aside and let him through. That was the way it was done. But that isn't what Jesus pays attention to. He sees, again, what is in the heart. So we never want to start to think as givers on the one hand that because we've done so much, somehow God owes us something, or because we've done so much that somehow we're due some sort of particular recognition. Again, as Sonny reminded us, Jesus doesn't see it that way. Jesus sees what it means. Jesus sees what a part of our lives it is that we are giving away. Jesus can tell the person who can write the $10,000 check just as easily as someone else can pull out a dollar. He sees and is able to sort that out. But it also means that there's no saying, gee, there's nothing I can do, because that's the other side, right? That's the temptation that, if big givers are just doing all they can, then maybe my gift doesn't matter. I don't have that much in the way of resources. Why should I even bother? No. Jesus reminds us, no, we all then have our responsibility. We all have a role to play. We all give to the one who sees what is in the heart, what it is that really matters. So why do we give? How do we receive? How should we approach things like budgets? How do we look at financial reports that are running over or running short? I would refer you back in closing to the old offertory prayer back in the green hymnal that I think still says it so beautifully. We used to come together after the offering and we would say that we give, and I quote, in joy and thanksgiving for what God has first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of his gracious love. So we don't give to budgets, we don't give to join the premier circle, we don't join to get recognized, we don't give to be recognized. We give, we do what we do, we give from the heart as we are able in joy and thanksgiving for what God has first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of his gracious love. We give not according to formulas or budgets, but we give because we recognize the fact that without God in the first place, we wouldn't be here. None of our resources would be here. Nothing that we consider our own would be and exist. And so we give out of the resources which, for the time being, God has given us. And you know, if you want to think about how unbusinesslike that is, consider when we turn, you know, on the television and the radio all the time for financial advice, we look to Wall Street experts or people on the television. Not in Jesus' world. He says, you want to learn what finance is all about, how to live with your personal resources? Check out the poorest of the poor, he says. If we ever need reminded, think of the widow. It can't get more unbusinesslike, it can't get more unworldly than that. Amen. Would you please join me in standing as we together make proclamation of our faith? We are using this morning again a portion of Martin Luther's explanation of the Apostles' Creed. Let us make that affirmation together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. This means that I believe that God has created me together with all that exists. God has given me and still preserves my body and soul, eyes, ears, and all limbs and senses, reason and all mental faculties. In addition, God daily and abundantly provides shoes and clothing, food and drink, house and farm, spouse and children, fields, livestock, and all property, along with all the necessities and nourishment for this body and life. God protects me against all danger and shields and preserves me from all evil.
All this is done out of pure fatherly and divine goodness and mercy, without any merit or worthiness of mine at all. For all of this I owe to God, to thank and praise, serve and obey him. This is most certainly true.
And you may be seated for the offering of the morning and the anthem. Church from empty piety. Stir up our will to act with mercy and compassion. We pray this Lord's Day especially for our conference neighbors at Salem Church in Kilmer and for their pastor, Godfrey Fiso. Keep also our bishops, all pastors, teachers, and all who proclaim your good news strong in faith. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
O God, provide all living things with sufficient food and clean water. Make us ever mindful of the farmers and laborers who supply us with food, and open our hands to share what we have received. Lord, in your mercy. O God, awaken our nation to care for veterans and others who have experienced the stress and trauma of war or other military conflicts. Especially we are mindful of this after the latest mass killing here in our country. Inspire us, we pray, to promote the well-being of those who have put themselves in the service of others. Lord, in your mercy. Bow down, O God, to meet those who are trampled. Greet them with mercy and give new life to those who feel overwhelmed or broken by discrimination, grief, illness, or other brokenness. We lift up especially this day Margaret, and Warren, and Henry, and Marzette, and Ron, and Marvin, and Sue, and Cora, and Martha, and Helen, as well as these loved ones known to us to be in need, whom we call by name. Lord, in your mercy. Bless the ministries in our community that reach out to people who are unnoticed or neglected. Give us a common vision of justice that eliminates hunger, greed, and self-righteousness. Lord, in your mercy. Bind us together, O God, with the saints of every time and place, especially Martin, Bishop of Tours, and Sven Kierkegaard, until we join them and all the saints to learn your name. Lord, in your mercy. Enfold all things in your compassion, O God, and bring us into your life through the faithfulness of Jesus, our Savior and Lord, who has taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Before the benediction, one additional announcement, and that is for next week's thank offering service led by the women of St. John, a women's pickup choir is being put together. And they're going to get together, Faye Louise, here at the piano. So if you're able to stay and sing with that group right after worship, just come scooting right up to the piano. They'll have a very quick rehearsal of that anthem as the plan. Thank you for that. And again, for Thanksgiving Eve worship, if you're able to help as a greeter, please let me know and check with me at the door about that. And now may the Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord's face shine on us with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. Amen.